And we are live. Good evening and welcome to the Logos broadcast live from Florida. And it's the 25th of October, 2020. Joining me now is Peter Richardson, an old primary school friend of mine. And he joins us now to sing his new single, The End of the World.
Thanks, Fergus. Slowly crawl to where you are, and the lights start dimming, even stars. Hope's all gone, I'm falling hard, and the children and women run through the dark. So you leave, 'cause you see something further, further down the line. And you say, although I don't show it, and I hope, yeah, I hope that I'll see you again. Whoa, 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 whoa. Slipping away. Sun's not coming out today. Yeah, you take it with you and hide it away. And the sky starts to fall and the mountains turn small and the floor starts to crumble. What is the world without that one girl, without that one girl who completes me? Oh, it's the end of the world if we know it. And I'm aching although I don't show it. And I hope, yeah, I hope that I'll see you again. It's the shattering of our illusion. Start of your new revolution, and I don't know if we'll make it in the end. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Ooh.
Peter, that was something else. Good man. Thanks for doing that. What? Tell us, what's that song about? What led you to write that? What was the inspiration?
So that song is a little bit about, basically just, I feel like it can apply to a lot of things, but in my head it was kind of when, like, the ending of things or dramatic moments in your life. And it's kind of about how in your own head it can feel like it's the end of the world. And it's about kind of like, it's about kind of the spirals that people go into, and the way that we trick ourselves into thinking that, like, this is the biggest thing ever. This is something of, like, biblical proportions, and it feels like it's the end of the world when it's your head. But the message of the song is that it's not really. It's just, so that's just kind of, I kind of just wrote that from the perspective of inside someone's head who's in that kind of space and thinking about that kind of thing, and just how everything feels so, like, apocalyptic, really.
So what kind of reaction have you got to the song so far? Obviously it's been on Spotify now a few weeks, is it? Or, like, I kind of joked to you there the other day. I said, yeah, are people stopping in the street, like, asking you for an autograph? Is that happening yet?
That's not happening, but it's been really amazing. I've been really blown away by the response. Like, Spotify give me kind of great statistics now, so I can see that people have been listening. And the biggest thing that has really blown me away is that with the audience, I think we're coming up on 4,000 listeners now in the first 2 weeks, which I'm blown away by. And the most incredible thing is that I can see that there's people around the world listening to it.
Yes.
So it's not just people from Dublin. I can get the statistics, and, like, our third country is Australia, and then we have, like, the Netherlands and all this kind of stuff.
Yes.
And even, like, South Africa and all of Europe, and people in the States as well. So that's been the thing that's really blown me away, is that there's been people all around the world listening to it. But yeah, it's been fantastic. I've been absolutely loving it.
You say we. Who are the others in the thing, or is that just a kind of a term that you use? Like, who has been part of this journey?
I tend to say we, because it just makes me feel more comfortable than saying,
okay,
I am doing this. But there are lots of people who have been massive helps to me. I have two close friends of mine from home. Big shout out to Jeff and Doran, who have been helping me with all the kind of the social media stuff. Running, like, uploading all the covers, all that kind of stuff, because it just makes the whole thing a lot easier, and they've been helping me record things and shooting the cover art. And then kind of music wise I've a very good friend of mine who I met in college. His name is Roy, and is very experienced in this thing, and he was kind of a bit of a producer for me, kind of came over and gives me, like, critical analysis on the songs, which is what you need. And then I have a friend, Louis, as well, who mixed and mastered the song.
Deadly.
A massive amount of work into that. So it's kind of a thank you to all those other people.
Okay.
Well,
that's lovely. And it's worth pointing out that it's worth checking out the Spotify version, because there is more backing music to it, right? It's not just you and the guitar. So that's definitely, people should definitely go and have a look at that.
Please.
If you don't mind, Peter, tell us about your musical journey so far.
So far, so from, do you want me to go from the very beginning?
Yeah, I mean, you don't need to tell us about your fifth class musical or whatever. Or you did have a part in that. You were.
I was.
Bill Sykes, but he wasn't singing.
No, he was.
So maybe you couldn't sing when you were 11. I don't know. But anyway, tell us about whatever. What's relevant?
What's relevant is that I grew up in a very musical household. I'm very lucky. I've been playing piano since I was like 10, and guitar since I was similarly, I think, like 14. So I was very lucky from the get-go that my parents kind of forced me into those things, and I grew up with a lot of music around the house. And then I think I started writing my own songs when I was about 15 years old. They were all terrible naturally, but I like to think they've gotten a little bit better since then. I've kept going and going, and I always wanted to do music. But I just really struggled to find the right opportunity, because, you know, with college and exams and work, I was working in a restaurant like 20 hours a week as well, and all this kind of stuff. So for years now, I've been building up a library of songs, just writing and practicing as much as I can, kind of waiting for the moment where I could give it 100%. And it was just the right time, because with COVID and stuff and lockdown, it just finally gave me the time to go after it 100% and get myself off the ground and get that first song out, because that's the biggest one. just getting that, making that first step takes by far the most work. So yeah, I've got managed to get myself off the ground now and kind of just get the ball rolling.
Exactly.
And now it's just going to keep going from here. I'm just going to keep working on my material and trying to release as much as I can and just make myself a better musician all around.
Yes, I remember the last time I saw you singing live was you sang in a musical in UCD and you were the lead male in American Idiot, and it was absolutely fantastic. But that has been, and I don't think they'll mind us saying this, but that's been a little bit of a strain, that engagement that you have with the musicals on your, let's say, individual pursuits. Is that fair to say?
It has been a strain, but also a massive advantage. It's been a bit of a hindrance. Purely, the only way that it's been any sort of strain is purely in sense of time, is that it takes up so much time that I didn't really have time to channel my own music. But I'm so much better off for it, because I did several shows with kind of UCD and through the Musical Society, and I grew so much then as a performer, really, but also as a singer. Like, I came out of those kind of, I've been my fourth year, came out of my third year with the UCD Musical Society with my voice so much stronger, so much more confident on stage as well, and just performing and putting myself out there. Like, I don't know if I would have been able to do this if I had never had that experience of putting yourself out there and all that kind of stuff. And then also just the people you meet and being in a musical environment. So like, the first time I played that song really live was at an open mic with the Musical Society, because you're surrounded by musical people who love the arts and stuff. And like, my producer Roy, I met through Musical Society and stuff. So I think all in all, it has been of a massive benefit to me, and I couldn't be where I am without it. But yeah, it does take up a lot of time, is the only thing.
So overall, a positive contribution to your journey, and absolutely. And now you have the time to really, let's say, max out, which is really exciting, obviously, for you. Tell us now, what is the dream? Do you see yourself in Madison Square Garden or Croke Park or, I don't know, Slane Castle? Or where will Peter Richardson be in 5 or 10 years?
I think obviously that is the dream. A big personal dream of mine is to play the Olympia, which I just love gigs at the Olympia so much. They're always so intimate. If any of our American people watching don't know, it's a very nice theater in Dublin where I've seen all my favorite gigs, and I'm pretty sure Fergus has seen a few gigs there as well. But yeah, just taking it as big as I can, really. And well, the ultimate goal is to just make good music. So if I can produce music that other people who I respect listen to and make music that they respect, that is the dream. To have people just say, I listened to your song and I enjoyed it, that is the absolute, that's the fundamental, that's the base dream. So if I had, I don't know, if I met like a musician that I admire or something one day, like a Hosier or something, and he told me that he respected my music and loved my song, that would be the most mind-blowing thing for me. But obviously,
but Peter, yeah, maybe he's watching, who knows?
Maybe he's watching, who knows? But yeah, the first goal is and will always be to just make the best music that I can, and make music that I myself would listen to and would enjoy, because music is such a huge part of my life, and there's so many musicians and songs that have influenced me so much. So imagining that I might ever write a song that would impact someone's life, or that someone would have as their favorite song, that really is the goal. That would blow me away.
Good man. Well, Peter, don't leave us, but you're going to temporarily leave us after singing another song, if that's okay with you, and then you'll join us again for round three. But what will you sing now, and what is the story behind that?
So I'm going to sing a song called The Coast. If for anyone who's ears were blown off a bit by the end of the world, this one's a bit more mellow. I wrote this. This was kind of the first of my. I started writing again in March once I got more time again. Had a massive burst of creativity and wrote loads. And this was the first big song that I wrote at the start of my most recent. I kind of go through phases where I write and write and write loads and have a big burst of kind of inspiration. So this was the first song that came out of that. And it's called The Coast. You'll hear the hook is Meet Me at the Coast. And it's basically about, I like to picture when I'm writing it, like a kind of a scene almost. And so a lot of and then base the song around that central image. So a lot of this song is based around the idea of just like sailing off to the sea. But with the greater message of kind of, it's really just about leaving past troubles behind and moving on to new things and not letting anything, any like demons, your past or whatever, drag you down. And also about the excitement of new things. So about the excitement of new moving on and starting something new. And
lovely.
leaving your ghosts behind you. So yeah, it's called The Coast.
Lovely. Well, whenever you're ready, Pete.
I'll take my headphones off so I can hear myself.
Good man.
Meet me at the coast when all this is over. Out across the rocks, down by the water, and I'll take it slow, save my time for you. But this glow in my chest is beating you. So let's move out of here, far from this place we call home. We can play it by ear, give it a year or so. If you meet me at the coast, bring all your favorite clothes. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Pack up all your bags and head to the harbor. Hold tight to the wheel as you point us to starboard. We can chase down the sun as it gets low, and the sky lights up pink and red and gold. 'Cause I'm so sick and tired of all this confusion and all that's been getting me low. But with you I feel wired, so when you feel ready to go, just meet me at the coast. Ooh, ooh. Bring all your favorite clothes. Ooh, ooh, ooh. I know this life is full of grief and fear untold. So if the time comes when you need a hand to hold, just meet me at the coast.
Peter, absolutely beautiful. Thank you for that. As again, come back to us in about 30 minutes, if that's okay. And I look forward to it. Thanks. See you soon.
Thank you.
Brian Barry joins us now. Someone has us on playing. Can you just mute that? Or I don't know which of you that is. But anyway, Brian, thank you for joining us today. We're here to talk about Gaelic games. And you are the Sky Sports GAA editor. And you've been busy this weekend. So tell us what you've been seeing from the press boxes of stadiums around the country. If you've been, you know, doing all that.
Yeah, first weekend of championship back, so fairly busy, all right, as you can imagine. I was in a Croke Park last night for the Dublin Leash game in the hurling. Dublin won fairly handy in the end, 14 points. So there was actually too much on today, unfortunately, so I didn't get anywhere myself. I was just working from the couch here. So, but okay. Good to be back anyway. Plenty going on and plenty to keep busy. So.
So are you allowed to break the 5K limit to get on the dart into Croke Park, or how do the rules work there?
Yeah. So the 5K limits were essential workers, essentially in communications. So
okay,
you're all right. So as you mentioned, traveling to Croke Park was actually one small benefit of all of this. Anyway, the fact that there's no fans, you're able to park right at the doorstep of Croke Park. So you know, it's rather than parking ages away or getting public transport and having to walk up and everything like that. So it's one small pro of it, all this anyway. So
yes, obviously minus the atmosphere of the crowd, but yes, you're focusing on the good. So what, tell us about what happened in the GAA this weekend. What matches were decided, and bring us up to speed here on what's going on.
Okay, hurling first, I suppose. We have the championship kicked off, essentially. So the football was finishing up its league this weekend, but the championship kicked off in the hurling. So Dublin went in against Laois. They got shocked by them last year, so they were kind of coming in to prove a point, essentially. Last year was very much a case of one step forward and two steps back by that loss to Laois. I'd say they took one step back in the right direction anyway. Won well, 231 to 23 points for Laois. They were too strong for them, really. Laois kind of played a sweeper, a containment game, and Dublin worked their way around it and kind of broke them down towards the end of it. They got their two goals either side of halftime, and it was kind of, they were more or less too strong for them. Similar scenes, really, in Thurles today. Limerick were playing Clare, level at halftime, and Limerick just completely blew them away out of the water. Same as last year, really, again. Limerick are looking very strong now. A lot of people's favourites for the All-Ireland. The team, they won Munster last year and kind of just got caught cold by Kilkenny in the All-Ireland semi-final. Obviously, they won that All-Ireland 2 years ago as well, so they're coming in strong. Especially, a lot has been made of winter hurling. The weather was good this weekend, at least dry, but in terms of if we get a wet weekend now and over the next few weeks, might kind of... the battles might be fought on different trenches, yes, kind of way, you know, when it's you need the bigger, bulkier fellas, and geez, the size of some of those Limerick fellas to get bigger every time they come out. Well, they certainly locked down well anyway. So that's how the hurling went off this weekend. The football, big news is Mayo are down. Mayo got relegated for the first time. Well, they were in the top tier since 1997. So one of the various guises anyway, but they've always been in the top tier since then. So relegated out of Division 1. They don't have too much time to feel sorry for themselves, I suppose. They have a championship coming up and they'll still fancy their chances of Sam Maguire. But they lost out to Tyrone at home by a single point today. So that's probably the main news from the football side of things.
And Kerry were victorious in the league.
They were, yeah.
So is that
the fact that?
Sorry, yeah. Go on.
It's always an afterthought, really. Like the hurling, actually, interestingly, the They didn't quite scrap the hurling league, but Clare and Limerick finished top of their two respective groups. So they decided, instead of playing a final or playing playoffs, they just declared them joint winners unless they were to meet in the championship, which they did today. So it actually doubled up, even though it was a Munster quarter final. There was a trophy at the end. So yes, Kerry won the league as well. To minimal aplomb, really. It was kind of eerie enough. There was no speech. David Clifford, their captain, went up, didn't even bother giving a speech, just lifted the cup and trudged back off. You know, they're playing Cork in a few weeks' time, and that's the big one for them. Like, you know, the league title would mean absolutely nothing to them if they go down to Porky Cove and get a licking down in 2 weeks. So.
Exactly. And just this is GAA time now, but don't go away if you're listening. If you have no interest in sport, and I'm sure a lot of people do, but we have Marie-Louise O'Donnell joining us in a few minutes. But Brian, tell us, what about the Dubs? They've won 5 All-Irelands in a row. Do they still have this invincibility factor post Jim Gavin? Or do you think maybe this is maybe the year where we might see, you know, the end of that era?
It's certainly the year there's the most question marks hanging over them. Certainly, as you mentioned, Jim Gavin is gone. Also, a lot of kind of senior members in the dressing room stepped away over the last 12 to 18 months. Paul Flynn went and Bernard Brogan went. Owen O'Gara's gone. Darren Daly went. Dermot Connolly went. And of course, Jack McCaffrey, who wouldn't be like at retirement age at all, but he stepped away from the panel, so he's not there. He kept him in at the last day, or in last year's first All-Ireland final, the drawn game. He scored 1-3 from play. There would have been no 5 in a row if it wasn't for him. And then obviously the big one, Desi Farrell coming in as manager. Is it a poison chalice, really? Because for him, if he does anything less than win the All-Ireland with them, you know, and even if he does win the All-Ireland with them, how much credit will he get? It's hard to know because it's Jim Gavin's team, or it's, you know, that's the mere continuation, etc. Dublin will win Leinster. You can put your house on that anyway. They haven't been beaten in Leinster since 2010, and it's only going in one direction, and it's not towards, they're not coming back to the pack. So they're going in, there's 2 games that Dublin can't be beaten in this year's championship. It's kind of probably the fact that there's no Super 8 is probably set up nicely for them. They'll be going in against the Ulster champions in the All-Ireland semi-final, or then the Connacht or Munster champions in the final. Who can beat them? Kerry can definitely beat them. They kind of went toe-to-toe with them the last few times. And the fact that if Kerry get everybody fit, the fact that Jack McCaffrey and Dermot Connolly, 2 real game winners for them, are gone and off the panel, perhaps. Donegal certainly have a high ceiling to trouble them, but the last few years they haven't kept everybody fit. Galway, we've seen flashes in the league, but they've kind of come back post-lockdown fairly flat. And of course, Mayo, you never know what to do on the day, but Kerry would be the main challengers to them absolutely this year.
So who's your money on for the hurling?
For the hurling? Probably off the basis of today's display.
There's a problem with the sound there. Are you there?
I am.
Yeah, sorry, keep going there, yeah.
Yeah, off today's display, probably Limerick. They hammered Clare really in the second half, just pulled away. And as I said, they're kind of a big physical team that might suit the winter hurling. A lot of people are kind of saying they were peaking nicely last year, hammered Tip in the Munster final. Tip went on to win the All-Ireland. But yeah, it's way open, to be honest. I'm going to give you a politician's answer. I'm very sorry. Galway and Wexford as well are 2 teams who kind of fancy themselves in the winter hurling. I don't think Kilkenny will win the All-Ireland. They could beat anybody on their day. Waterford aren't going to do it, and Cork aren't going to do it this time of year. So politician's answer, I'll narrow it down to 4 for you anyway. Tipperary, Limerick, who, if you had to push me, I'd tip, and then Wexford and Galway.
Okay, very good. Well, we have a former politician about to join us, so maybe that was on your mind. But I want to ask you briefly, can you comment on the politics, actually, of the GAA in recent weeks and months? Because the elite levels have been prioritised and exempt from the restrictions to which everyone else must adhere. So is there consensus in the organisation that what's being done is the best way forward?
I think there is. There's broad support. I wouldn't say there's consensus. There is. The GPA surveyed its members, and 75% odd had kind of backed the championships going ahead in some shape or form, and that was as recently as 10 days ago. So there's within the plane, and they're the most important stakeholders, they're the ones actually risking their health going out in the midst of a pandemic. Does the country need it? I'd argue yes. Is it proportional? Perhaps yes. The fact that there were 20 odd inter-county games this weekend, that'll be whittled down. There'll only be one weekend come December, so it'll be whittled down. It'll be reduced and reduced. Everybody's kind of made the point that it's important for the mental health of the country, stuff like that. People are sitting down and watching it, and it's given some people something to talk about. But they also think other people perhaps aren't talking about is the fact that if there's games on every Saturday and Sunday afternoon on the television, there's hundreds of thousands of people sitting down and watching that. They're not going out socializing, or they're not going out there's no better form of social distancing than sitting down on your couch in your own living room and turning on the television, you know. So probably lends itself to that for the sake of the 50 odd people it takes to actually put on an inter-county hurling or Gaelic football match. It's probably argue that it's certainly worth kind of the major risk for people.
Yes,
you're getting 600,000-800,000 people sitting at home in their living room to watch it. So but yeah, overall, to answer your question, certainly within the association, it's largely supported anyway. Yeah.
Well, I will leave this little interaction with an anecdote. I spoke to one of the coolest senior hurlers today, Emmett Murphy, and I put it to him that to prioritise the elites and abandon the grassroots seemed to me like a contradiction of the ethos of the GAA. But he, to be fair, he pointed out that the inter-county game had to stop over the summer while the club games were allowed to continue. So there was that sort of compromise reached. And from his perspective, he said he'd much rather be poking a slither in June and July than in the less forgiving weather conditions that is from now, you know, as the weather gets a bit more miserable and all that. So I suppose it's not like the club has been completely forgotten. So I just, that kind of is worth pointing out. But Brian, thank you very much for joining us, and best of luck with the season.
Cheers. Thanks very much, Fergus.
Slán tama. Now, Marie-Louise.
Hello.
Hello. Oh, hold on. I just muted Marie-Louise there by accident. Marie-Louise, I've muted you. Let's see. Ask to unmute.
Okay. Can you
hear
me?
There we are. I can. Thanks, Marie-Louise. Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. I wouldn't mind you doing it halfway through, but at the beginning, it's not too great.
Okay. When you're digging yourself a hole, maybe, I don't know.
Not at all.
No.
Actually, very good, because I'm hopeless at this, and you've set it up quite brilliantly. So I've done nothing but just obeyed your instructions.
Very good. Well, Marie-Louise, tell me, first of all, about what life has been like for you since the end of your time in the Shannon.
It hasn't been great, you know. I suppose COVID, if you can say something helped, it helped in the sense that we're all kind of without certainty and without insurance and assurance about our future. And COVID kind of helped in a way, because there is a big gap, you know, when you leave something as not as urgent as the Senate, but as where you feel so significant, you know, and then you're retired as well, in the sense that you've not only the Senate is finished, but I was retired from my job in DCU. And then you're looking at Morse, you know, and Poirot, and looking out the window and wondering, what am I going to do now? And then it's not as easy maybe to connect with people, because they themselves are unsure and uncertain, and their jobs are unsure and uncertain. And people within all kinds of NGO works has come to a stop. Like, even the voluntary work has somewhat come to a stop. Things you might have thought you might get involved in, travel, you know, to go to other counties to help, to be involved in different, on different boards. People, voluntary boards now would say, we'd love to have you when this is all over, do you know?
Yes.
So it hasn't been easy, but there are other aspects of it as well. You know, that you do the garden, you sit down, you think, you walk, you read. It's hard not to sometimes know, what the hell am I going to do tomorrow? You know? you know, because I always had something to do or a place to go or people to see or projects to understand. I didn't kind of hang around, and hanging around with yourself is not easy, but I'm there's a lot of people in the same boat, but there's still joy and there's still spring and music and the spring to come and music and the arts and
yes,
great drama and good reading and good friends and good conversations, you know.
So what one of your causes, if not the primary cause that you took up recently, was that of older people.
Yeah.
And you often use the term our elders. So how do you think this has, what has this taught you, and what has this time taught us about how we view this section of the population?
Well, it's a good question. You see, a lot of the time you always bring your own pathology to where you are. Like my mother is 97 and she's been minded by the Little Sisters of the Poor in Dublin. And I never thought Mummy would be in a nursing home because she was terribly alive and physically active right up into her 90s. But in her mid-90s, we needed more than just home help and our help. And so you get to know, it's your own pathology then comes to the fore, and you become aware then of what is happening, our elders. And I call them elders because the Greeks called them elders. You know, they used to have choruses of elders in their plays. I don't like old people. I like the idea of elders because I like the experience and the wisdom that they come with, you know. So I'm one myself. If you're over 50 now, you're done for. And if you're over 60, well, you might as well go out and buy the grave, you know, the way they're carrying on. But I think, you know, I had been very influenced by Margarita Solon as well, who ran the Macaulay Place in Nace. And it's an independent living space for about 50, 60 residents. But she used what they call a creative model as opposed to a medical model, a creative and social model. And I think we haven't given that enough attention, because of course people need safety and they need warmth and they need food and they need help. And some people mightn't be able, you know, to be in any way independent, but there are many people in nursing homes. In fact, the Alone report said there was something about 12,000 of our elders in nursing homes who didn't need to be there, except they didn't have community help or families weren't around, they were in other countries. But we need to look at creative and artistic and social models for how we deal with elders in nursing home settings or in settings where they're in within communities. The government have tried a little with that and kind of having independent living within communities and specific to the kind of needs. But we still think of old people as kind of sitting there, and not only are they they're unable to move because they may be old and have arthritis, but their brains aren't moving, you know, or their minds aren't moving, and they are alive to everything. One of the greatest examples of that recently was, I think, the National Symphony Orchestra, some of the quintets and quartets from the orchestra during this time of COVID went and played in courtyards, you know, in September. We had a really lovely September in August and September, and played with the windows open to the elders. And you could see the transformation, you know, even on their faces. Like when you, that they just were brought back, and they played melodies from the 40s, 50s, 60s, and they played Mozart, and they played melodies that they would know and love and bring back memories. Like I just, that should be as important as physiotherapy or as occupational therapy. And I think that the Arts Council, or where if the government gives money to the arts, which it does, that one of the prerequisites is that anybody studying arts or music, like that singer you had on, anybody studying any level of arts should have to spend time within communities of our elders. That is a prerequisite for any money they're given, and that the Arts Council should have a huge system and organization where that happens. And that would have an awful lot of artists now, musicians, poets, playwrights, writers. I mean, what would, you know, being able to actually perform, movement artists being able to perform when they're out of work and being able to keep their own artistic expressions alive. Now, I mean, I think that's what it taught me as well. I mean, I suppose loneliness, you know, I mean, there's books being written on loneliness now. Keith Swanick, he was a senator with me. He had did a massive report on loneliness in Ireland because he has a practice way down and way down the coast of Mayo. People dismiss these kind of words, you know, as if, oh, that's just for in a poem or something, or that's in a book. But it's just a deep, profound feeling of loss and isolation without conversation or another human being. And, you know, people in nursing homes, you know, healthcare assistants, and they have so much to other do that those spaces are not filled in, really. And
so, yeah.
So that's a huge area, Fergus, and it's one that we just need to realign, like Margarita Solan did, a social and artistic model alongside the medical model. And so, I think it would give a lot of artists work.
It would. On a practical level, Marie-Louise, one way, supposing you were to sing a song, and just supposing that was to happen, and I was to record it, and I was to bring it out to all the nursing homes in Ireland, or put it on RT1 or RT2. Obviously, it's not the same as the in-person interaction, but it's some sort of attempt at providing stimulation of some sort. What do you make of the creative output that is available on our TV screens at home in recent times, specifically through RTE? Like, this might be a bit cliched at this stage, but I remember staying up late on, I think it was a Sunday night or a Monday night, to watch Love Hate. And that was a huge hit a few years ago, but that's probably 10 years ago, five, you know. So what, is there anything now that you would say we're on the right track, do you know, in that regard, or is it all doom and gloom?
Well, No, it's not all doom and gloom, but again, there isn't the same emphasis. There isn't the same emphasis for our orchestras to play. And funnily enough, I did see them play recently, and there has been some concerts from the National Concert Hall, you know, streaming on our RT have been doing. And there's been one or two things in the Ivy Gardens where there's been some poets speaking and some dialogue and duologue conversations and some musicians. And that's been good. We need more of that. We fall constantly into the interview, you know, into the interview or the magazine format. We also fall into the copying. We copy other programs, you know, other kinds of dramas, other kinds of house bills, other kinds of quiz shows, other kinds of comedy shows. And when we do, when we're more original with our own ideas, we're much better. There are those who say, oh, well, of course, the arts costs money, it costs this. It doesn't really, because you'll get it back in your audiences. I think we need more of it. We don't have enough. We don't have short dramas, short musicianships. It's all talking about the arts, but maybe not doing it.
Yes.
Like sometimes when I listen to the arts on radio, the arts program on radio, which is good, I don't, everybody's arguing and everybody's a critic, but let me hear it and let me feel it and let me sing it and let me dance it even. Dinjo did it on the radio. Let me dance it. There's not the same emphasis. It's all about either profit or either marketing or either advertising, and not the same emphasis on why don't we have an hours arts program? Well, Jules Holland did it with musicians. What's wrong with us trying to do it with poets or with dancers or with both or with musicians? We can't always stop and say, well, that's going to cost too much. It's not, because in the end, people will watch the station. They won't go elsewhere. And we don't give enough platform. Don't give enough platform to country music. I mean, the Late Late does it, but you can't ask the Late Late to do everything. You can't. We should have a proper book program with passages from the program, with people talking about bits done from it. We're not doing enough of it. And there's too much a capitulation to a copying of everything else. That's on other stations, and also dragging people in to have conversations. You know, there's nothing wrong. Why wouldn't we take something like Mihol O'Sullivan's work now? Just give an example of Mihol O'Sullivan's work, and maybe just create a whole half hour of Irish images to it, or maybe have poetry through it, or maybe have young people say what it evokes in them. It's not just my, there's a thousand different ways you can bring the arts alive if you sit and stop thinking about interviewing somebody. Because really, I hope I'm not coming across a
bit. Well, no, this is the thing, Marie-Louise, maybe.
Click factor. But God, you get so fed up with listeners, the same people
yes.
saying the same things very badly.
Well, Marie-Louise, you sound like a critic who maybe would be, no, but that's not a bad thing, but maybe you should try your hand at it yourself. Have you? I know I'm teasing you now, but the last time we spoke, we were kind of laughing and you promised me a ticket to the front row of your play if that ever materializes. So I know I'm being annoying here, but do you ever really think, yes, there's a lack here, that's not good, why don't I go and throw myself in, throw the hat in the ring?
Wonderful there. And you know what I really admire about it is your youth and vigor and resilience. You know, sometimes when you get to my age, it's awful hard to self-perpetuate once again, you know? I mean, you're right. And one of the greatest times in my life was, well, they were all great, but was in the Helix, you know, out in DCU when we were creating something from nothing. There was a piano there with a big, with the huge big bolt on it that you put on an iron gate. But you are right. It's all, I don't mean to be a critic. I mean more to be a creative thinker, you know, yes. about ways forward. Because I'm the very one to sit back and say, isn't that marvelous? Wasn't he? Like there was a wonderful, it got bad reviews, interestingly. Not bad, but they were a bit iffy. The Confessors, the other night, done by Alex Fagan. Film he did the hundred year old Ireland, you know, people who are 100 years age, and he also did one on the pubs of Ireland, the oldest pubs in Ireland. But this was wonderful, and I found myself sitting back, made by an Irish guy, about the confessional in Ireland and about what has happened and where people go now and what it stood for and then what it became and what it's now. And I'm thinking, isn't that marvelous? So much so the BBC had it. Hmm. 3 days later. So we can do it. It doesn't have to be a play. It can be an artistic approach. But in relation to my own play, which was supposed to be about elders, about my own pathology, I suppose, with my mother and how I see it now and how it evokes something about Ireland. Hmm. You're right. It's kind of, will I show you something?
Go for it.
Blank page. The blank page. So I'm kind of embarrassed now. I'm going to have to start, Fergus.
Well,
and do it, you know.
Speaking of your mother, do you mind me asking about her and your experience of her experience of this time? As you said, she's yeah. being cared for by others, and she's quite old. So you probably can't, you know, touch her and hug her or whatever you would usually do. So what's that been like for you? You know what I mean?
Not easy. She's very accepting. She was always very accepting, Mummy. You know, her name was Maura Cranny, and people would have known her because she taught nearly everybody in Ireland. And she was interested in theatre and drama and dance and music. And she was teaching Milton to nine-year-olds. She always had this idea that if you elevate, you know, if you elevate, which is another thing we don't do in television a lot, we copy the non-elevated areas. But she was a great elevator and inspirer, you know, and she was interested in voice and choral verse and musicals and dramas and adjudication and, oh, she was just something. Now, she never, you know, so much so it was like, I'm a product of, well, was she ever in the house? No. Did she ever cook you a meal? No. Did she ever put down a fire? No. So I'm a product of the politician's child, you know, or the doctor's child or the writer's child who never really saw the children. And there's no regrets there at all. That's the way life was. And we thought everybody else was like that. So now in behind the window, when I get to see her 15 minutes a week, she never railed against life and said, this is wrong and that is wrong. And why is this and why is that? She was always very accepting. And it's something I really never really learned. Maybe I'm learning it as I get older.
Wow. But
she never suffered from anxiety, and she'll smile and, you know, and accept the fact that that's the way it is. And I'll say, Mummy, you know, the virus is out here. Oh, it's not coming in here, is it? No, it's not getting in there. That's why we're all out here freezing, you know.
Yes.
But so she's back with the nuns as well, too, that she worked for and with for years. You said they're a French order, the Little Sisters of the Poor, mm-hmm. and a great order. So she's not affected because she's quieter in herself and content. And Mummy had a tendency to live in a virtual reality. So her work and her imagination and her own creativity kind of brought her into other worlds. And those other worlds now are just part of her life. Wow. And she doesn't rail against what's going on outside the window. She'll say, "Can you not come in?" And no, we can't, Mummy. But she doesn't look for reasons. She just, it's what the philosophers call it, acceptance, which
exactly.
I have not learned.
It sounds like she is at peace, you know, and yes, content yes. with a life well lived. And it sounds like well it yes. was indeed a life well lived. Do you mind me pivoting a little bit to the American energy and madness? I'm right now in Florida, which is up for grabs. Say that again.
Where Trump voted.
Yes, exactly. In person. Say it again.
And told the press, I have voted for a man called Donald Trump.
Speaking in the third person, apparently that's a big sign of, you know, whatever, narcissist or what, obviously, you know, but apparently that's a telltale sign that you love yourself, you know.
Come on.
Of course.
It was a fun remark.
No, it is. I know, but look, you know, look, I'm not jumping on the chorus.
It doesn't matter what he says.
Of Trump bashing. Yeah, he doesn't. So tell me about, yeah, go on.
Because they crucified him yes. for the laugh. He's a most interesting individual. I don't subscribe to the crucifixion, because the crucifixion started 4 years ago and it's never stopped. And they took a word beginning with A, maybe appalling, and then they went on, and the writer went right through the dictionary, Roger's thesaurus, right through the dictionary till they got to xenophobic. And it's never stopped. And it's gone on day and night and night and day and day and night. And it's kind of like a mantra, so much so that I don't listen anymore. Sure, we know all the things, but they just get worse and more expanded. And the Irish Times spent weeks, months, years telling us how appalling he was. Mm. How appalling he was. He has a lot of problems. He's a lot of energy and he's a lot of fearlessness. Mm. And he's great fun, and he's mad, and he's not mad in an insane sense. He's just a man. One of the things I learned in politics, no matter what you think about politicians, they always have somewhere in the back of them or somewhere in them a sense of doing something for the other, for the common good, or making, even if it's getting somebody a medical card, doing something. And Trump, you have to have that as a politician, a belief that you can do something, raise the level of something, change people's lives, even if you're only eating the elephant a bit at a time. Donald Trump, his sense is of himself. He doesn't really have a sense he's going to do something for somebody else. Mm. It's mainly for Donald, or else Donald is in the reflection of it. So first problem as politician. But there was, for a few years before, maybe it'll stop people roaring and bawling and screaming, that we have to have businessmen as politicians. It should be businessmen and the heads of banks and the heads of insurance companies running countries. No, we shouldn't, because you're into the whole profit management there. And they got one, and they voted Donald Trump in. And that is not the kind of person who's interested in the common good. So he's not a president of the United States. He's not a politician.
Well, Marie-Louise, he would see that, and a lot of people found that.
As an advantage.
Yes, because he's made his money already. The likes of Biden and the boys are millionaires thanks to their positions that they hold and the donations that they get and the lobbying to which they are subjected. And Trump, he would say that he's not dependent on pleasing, you know, the big boys and on Wall Street or Amazon or whoever, because he's made his millions already. So
yes,
there's nothing financially in it for him, at least.
Yes, but they have expectations about his behavior, and his behavior was non-diplomatic and non-political, you know, and non-mannerly. and coarse at times, and, you know, wayward. And, you know, that is what really upset people, the waywardness and the coarseness of the behaviour, a kind of behaviour you'd go on with in the back and in the middle of a barbecue with a few jars on. Like, yes. That is not, you cannot behave like that. There are limits and boundaries when you become a representative, even of a county. Mm. You know, when you become a leader of a team, you can't go on like that. So, and wasn't prepared to take advice. However, he has been excoriated to the point where he's now Barabbas on a cross. Like, it is. And you begin to think, how much more of this punch bowl can he take, or will he take, or should he take, you know? And yet, you know, and Joe Biden, I'm sure, is a wonderful man. And a very genuine man, but I have not heard anything about Joe Biden for years. I didn't remember Joe Biden. He didn't make an impact on me even when he was vice president, whereas other people would have made impacts on you, other vice presidents. So I don't know how that's going to work out. It's a difficult choice. I would excoriate him for different reasons. It's just that the mantra has become so cliched. And he has, if you ever notice with Trump, he has power, you know, and he has stature and he has the walk and he loves the part he's playing, except he's not playing it very well because he's playing a Jacobean cardinal, you know, and they were tough guys, you know, they were really tough guys behind the arras, but he hasn't. He needs training for that. Politics is for the long game. You need training, diplomacy, manners, language. He says things without language at times, and they're innocent and silly. And you can see him in the act of thinking. Politicians don't like to be caught out in the act of thinking in case they get the thinking wrong. Exactly. And he's not taking advice. And he's not being, he needs, I know a few people, very, very good advisors that he should have taken on, and they might have put some order and some boundaries on him because he has talent. The Americans have a tendency to talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk on CNN and talk and talk and talk and talk, and you wonder after 2 hours, what the hell was all that about?
Not a lot, Marie-Louise.
Yeah, they also have a tendency to confuse reality with TV reality. You know, they're very different, and he doesn't, he plays TV reality when the journalists are being very real, and he treats them as if they're on The Apprentice, and it annoys them. It really angers them.
Yeah.
And so that's, he doesn't make that distinction, but he has something. He's entertaining. I mean, I don't want to hear any more dinner parties people say I have to eat in the kitchen because I mean, I argue about him. But he has something. He's entertaining. I tell you, there's an awful lot of people in America, including relations of mine, who say I have more money in my pay packet. They don't see it, you see, as something other than that, you know. If he had Putin's KGB training, mental training, we might, and his control, not necessarily his politics, but he might get somewhere. And I also, he didn't really have an understanding of the world. Well, the world is a tough place, and he wasn't. You need to read, you need to travel, and you need to read, and you need, you know, to and you need to converse. But I'm going to make a prediction. He'll win.
You think so?
Well, so, like, I've excoriated, like, yes. Myself up on another cross. Yes. Yes, he'll win.
Well, Marie-Louise, let me just finally ask you, if you had the keys to the Taoiseach's office and it was you in the shoes of Micheál Martin, how would you be leading the Irish country, the Irish state, and what level of restriction would you place on its people? Do you think right now we're doing the right thing, or would you have doubts about that?
Well, we're in a major, let me put it this way. We're in a major contradiction because the epidemiologists and the virologists and the molecular guys and the pathologists and they're contradicting each other. There's levels, there's very different levels of opinion, and I'm not a medic. So it's hard for me to come down on one side and the other, because I want the people who are fragile, who are elders and who have underlying conditions to be protected. But I think that our young and our youth and our businesses and our life force has to be let breathe. It has to be. And we have to make that distinction. And you also have to rely on the Irish people, stop treating them and telling them what they can't do and telling them that you have absolute faith in them to be responsible. There'll always be those who'll turn Turk. Always. And let that can be dealt with. But I think Irish young people are completely responsible in relation to this, because they have mothers and aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters who may have underlying conditions, and they're not purposely undermining that. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to be very careful here how we deal with this. And I also would say to the Taoiseach, he promised us a commission of care. Where is it? Where is the commission of care? And COVID is a very good time to start major creative things, massively creative things, and to give things a go and a chance. Like the musicians you had on, a wonderful singer, you know, all of those people, to give them a chance to get out there and pay them to get out there and be part of a whole structure within our elders and within, you know, not just waiting for the next gig, but to be absolutely inculcated and integrated into what we do. And the Arts Council need to stop giving out money and start thinking like that. And the government needs to start thinking like that. And we need to hear more from our ministers. I mean, more. We'll open their mouths and stop arguing against each other and telling us what they can do. I mean, anyway, that would be my opinion on this and the commission of care.
Hmm. Well, Marie-Louise, you know where the go on.
I hope we meet again.
No, we will, of course. And there's plenty of time to talk again. And thank you very much for joining us this evening. It's always something that I enjoy your company. And so thank you for that.
Thank you, Fergus. Thank you. Bye bye.
And we'll start now, or we'll finish with some Peter Richardson. Our first ever live performer on the Lagos broadcast. But before Peter plays again, I would just like to say a few thank yous. Thank you very much for listening or watching, if you are listening or watching. Thank you to my guests tonight, Peter, Brian and Marie-Louise. Thank you to my friends and family for their support over the last while. And I must give special mention to my brother Kevin, who bought me this microphone for my birthday last month. Also, thank you to Emmett Murphy for his research, and my brother Sean, and my mother and father, Caroline and Sean, for their editorial input. Please join us again next week. I will have some very special guests to talk about you too, to mark the 20th anniversary of their album, All That You Can't Leave Behind. In the meantime, please don't be a stranger. Email fergusjamesmurphy.com@gmail.com if you have any suggestions for the show. And please consider sharing these interviews and performances with your friends, foes and family on various anti-social media platforms. And remember to come back next week at 7 p.m. Irish time and 2 p.m. Eastern time and 1 p.m. Central time to listen to a thought-provoking discussion on U2. Peter will sing one more song for us, Peter Richardson. Feel free to sing along if you know the words.
Thanks a million, Fergus. Thanks for having me. We're going to finish off with the parting glass. So enjoy. Of all the money that I had, I spent it in good company, and of all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit to memory now, I can't recall. Song filled to me the imparting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. Of all the comrades that e'er I had, they are sorry for my going away. And of all the sweethearts that e'er I had, they would wish me one more day to stay. But since it calls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and I'll softly call. Good night and joy be with. Good night and joy be with you.